Oxford from the inside. The good, the bad, but always the truth.
Hey guys, it's Sam. Welcome to Oxford from the Inside, the good, the bad, but always the truth. Today we're here with Jamie, Conrad and Carlotta. Could you guys like to introduce yourselves?
Hi, I'm Jamie. I'm going into third year studying philosophy and linguistics at Jesus College.
I'm Conrad. I'm going into my third year studying philosophy, politics and economics at Trinity.
Hey everyone, I'm Carlotta. I'm going to my second year of philosophy, politics and economics, also at Trinity.
All right, so today we're going to be talking about advice on the thinking skills assessment. This is the admissions test you need to take for if you're going to be applying for the subjects economics and management, PPE, PPL and experimental psychology and human sciences. So to start it off, how did you guys prepare for the TSA? If you want to start, Jamie.
Sure, I prepared very heavily. I did all of the practice papers. And so one of the key tips I would give is that after I did them, I marked them using the mark schemes online, and then I would go through all of the answers very slowly and figure out where I went wrong and try to understand every single one I got wrong. And for quite a lot of the ones that I found difficult, but still got right, I tried to understand what it was that made my answer right as opposed to others. I also did use a couple of the books out there for some more practice questions. And I even did kind of some psychometric tests to improve some of my spatial reasoning and stuff.
Nice. Wow.
So my answer is going to be basically very similar. I can speak for the mindset I had at the time, which was I knew that the purpose of the TSA was really to test how you think and wasn't the sort of thing that technically you're supposed to be able to revise for. So really the thing that I wanted to improve the most was my speed and efficiency. So I very much consciously drafted essentially a three-step method of preparing for it. The first one, and this is where for me all these resources were useful, was learn heuristics for different sorts of questions, which we'll get into in the future. But for example, what is the main conclusion? Are you read in a book? Oh, the therefore test is a really nice way of doing it. Note that down. Then essentially just practice question after practice question after practice question, always timed right from the get-go for me, so I could work and improve my speed. But then afterwards do extensive sort of long form checking, going through each of them, seeing where I went wrong, and then just bring it up to the next time. So that was basically it for me, but it was all about being as efficient as possible.
What about you, Carlos?
I can only add to what Conrad and Jamie have said. So I don't think I was as systematic as Conrad about it, but I did start doing past papers, and I had sort of one book with more past questions, and I started going through them slowly and sort of seeing what I could do. And then by going through the mark schemes and looking at really trying to get right each question and looking at how I went wrong, sort of figured out which questions I was already better at and which questions I was not getting. And then that also gave me an idea of sort of how much time I would be taking for each question in the exam and which questions to potentially sort of skip over if they start taking too long. That was my tactic. And then by the end, of course, I did sort of full practice papers under exam conditions just to get a feel for how that works.
So I know, Conrad, you said that you from the beginning did the papers in timed conditions. Is there any value in taking your time with the first few papers? Because I remember, because I did section one of the paper, I remember it being quite time challenging for anyone.
I think there can be, if you're the sort of person who needs to do that just to get yourself into the rhythm. But the thing for me was I realized that if I had 2-3 hours to do this paper, it probably wouldn't be that hard. So it's going to be a very different experience running through these questions timed versus running through these questions. And it's really running through these questions timed that they're testing you. So for me, it was really important to get as much time to practice in as possible.
Yeah, I'd actually just add to that. I'd say the opposite of Sharp, not of Conrad. I agree with Conrad, but I'll go. Right. I would not suggest doing the first one in slower conditions. Because the key, as Conrad said, is the time. It's an easy test if you have 3 hours. it's a really hard test once you have 90 minutes.
Yeah.
I would suggest do two or three papers under strict time conditions, definitely. That's where you actually probably see the biggest increase in like mark is probably those first three practice papers. The next 10, 20, you're going to see like reduced returns each time that you do them if you're really going ham. What I would suggest if you are going to do some extra papers, which is what I chose to do, but you don't need to do, is that at that's the stage where you can start doing them slower. Because as Conrad says, it's a really easy test if you do it in 3 hours. So I did that. I did every single question until I felt like I was confident with every answer. It took me about 2.5 hours. And then marked it, I got like 48 or 49. I was like, right, okay, if I can get 48, I will definitely have a really top score, right? So then I thought, okay, I've just got to introduce speed and efficiency, exactly what Conrad said. So I could cut out half an hour pretty easily just by making sure that I'm working quicker, not like staring off into the distance. Like I ended up creating like a little, a little symbol system for me to like know which questions I wanted to come back to. Yeah. So if I was like, okay, I've done the question, I'm happy with it, I would just tick it. If I wanted to come back to it, I'd like underline it. And if I hadn't answered it, I would like circle it, something like that. Just things like that, little things which would like cut off 5-10 minutes
exactly.
at a time. And I just got quicker at it. Like the more you do them, the quicker you do that, you become at ease with them. And we'll, as Conrad alluded to, we'll discuss the different types of questions.
Yeah.
But you start to really pace through them. So I could get down to doing a paper getting like, I don't know, 45 in like an hour and 45. And so in the real thing, I knew that it was literally just about making sure that I try to get through as many with that level of confidence as possible within the time. So I'd say, yeah, go through that that process of just doing it where you're confident and then cutting down time. But when you're going through questions afterwards, like going through the mistakes you make, take as much time as you want. Try and actually get into the mind of the TSA and like understand why your answer was wrong. Because sometimes I would look at the answer, I'd be like, oh, well, yeah, obviously I made a silly mistake. Sometimes I'd be like, I still think my answer is correct. And that's where you really need to take the time to understand where you went wrong and why you went wrong.
And just to go back to that important point, is there like any room for debate with the answers? Like say you've got like your answer and it's not right. Like are you always wrong?
If we're talking about section one, yeah.
Yeah. Basically. Might not feel like that, but yeah.
Yeah.
Damn, that's I think that's actually some good news and like, I know, important feedback, because I imagine a lot of people doing it will stand quite strong with their answers.
Yeah, and I think the advantage of doing loads of practice papers is you get to see like some of the reasons why you keep thinking it's one way when it's the other, and so on. So yeah, you are wrong, but just do more and hopefully it will become clear to you why.
Yeah, I agree with that entirely. Like the more you do, the more, like I've like made answers to, I think like 350, like basically all the questions that exist out there. And there are a few that I didn't understand, like I still did not understand. And as I would go on, I would start to understand. And there are probably like, there's only probably about one or two now where I still feel like I don't understand why that was the answer.
Damn. Okay. So going into more about the TSA, what type of TSA questions are there?
Okay, so there's two parts of the part one paper. So there's like the problem solving questions and the critical thinking questions. So the problem solving questions, they have like, there's more variety to them. So they often involve like tables and graphs, and you have to like read information off of those tables and graphs. And the tables and graphs can be involved in both the answers or in the like questions. Some of them are like involve spatial reasoning. So that can often be like rotating a cube in your mind or something like that. And then there's also just general like numerical ones and just like kind of general problem solving ones, which are very difficult to like put into a box. But they're pretty obvious like which ones those are. And then the critical thinking side, that's where there's like a paragraph of text. Then they will ask you for something about that, the argument in that text. So they might ask what the main conclusion of that text is, or what conclusion you could draw from the text. They could ask you like if there is an answer which has the same reasoning as the text, or whether it might ask you to find the principle underlying the text. It may ask you for a flaw in the argument or for the assumption underlying the argument, or it may ask you for a strength or weakness of something which might make the argument stronger or weaker. So those are kind of like the seven types of critical thinking question. And you'll notice it, as you start doing practice, like where they are, they actually have the exact same questions in the same places in all of their past papers, pretty much from 2009-2010. So you'll get used to doing them.
Is there anything you guys want to add?
No, that was pretty much everything.
Yeah, I mean, I think figuring out for yourself which type, so obviously if you have one of these books to prepare, looking in there, but I think we've said that the books sort of split it up differently as well. Just figuring out for yourself which types of questions there are and what system you have to answer them. So when you see the word conclusion in the question, you know what you need to do to get that answer, and then you understand why your answer is the right one. And I think that's, again, where just loads and loads of practice will help.
Nice. So going in a bit more, talking about section one of the TSA, do you guys have any advice for the problem-solving questions for section one? Starting with Carlotta.
Sorry, you cut out there.
So do you guys have any advice for the problem-solving questions in section one?
So I think for the problem-solving questions, I preferred the problem-solving questions to the critical thinking ones, like the spatial reasoning ones. I enjoyed doing those because I sort of enjoyed that kind of puzzle. But they also didn't turn, I think there's less of them than the critical thinking ones. Correct me if I'm wrong. And they're also, sorry?
There's 25 problem solving and 25 critical thinking.
Oh, okay. Fair enough. So for example, the spatial reasoning ones I enjoyed, but they also, it was much more difficult on those to develop a system than for the critical thinking ones. Then there's obviously the numerical reasoning ones, which is mostly maths. I hadn't done maths in a while when I started preparing for the test. So that took a lot of practice and a lot of sort of sitting down and just going over basic things that I needed to know. But in general, for the problem solving ones, I think just splitting them up into those three categories, seeing which ones you might need more time for. For me, it was definitely the problem-solving questions that I needed more time for than the critical thinking ones in the exam. And so they were the ones that I was also more likely to kind of skip over in the first run and then go over when I realized I had extra time.
Yeah. Okay. Anything
I could speak for a very long time on the critical thinking and not really the problem-solving, which explains the marks that I got. But I guess some of the stuff that is transferable is, which I'll talk about in a lot more detail when we get onto that, is this idea of heuristics. So there are lots of things you want to do for all of the questions, which are all about, you see a question, you know the type of question it is, what is the first thing I'm going to do, way to approach the question, what procedural method do I have in place? And that's something you want to be thinking about applying to these questions. So for example, you'll see plenty of questions which have a graph full of information looking at them, and you could spend time reading, but something which you may want to do is look at the question first, see what it says, which month of 2013, for example. You now know, right, I can completely disregard this, look at the answers, and it only lists you five of those months, right, I can completely disregard all of those other months, and then just get to adding or doing whichever calculations you need to do for those. And so thinking about methods and getting methods from books you read and stuff like that in those terms, in ways of just ways to look at a question and instantly rule out things you don't need to do, have a set procedure in mind, is sort of what I just recommend for all of these questions, especially if you see them more than once.
Yeah, exactly what Conrad said. For those at the back, shout out to Ladder, you like, do not start by reading through the entire graph. Start that for both types of questions. The first thing you should do is read the like last line before the answers, which is the question. It will say something like, what is the main conclusion of this argument? Which month was the busiest in terms of footfall? Or something like that, right? All of a sudden, you've cut down the amount of information you're searching for. That saves you time. And time is the golden currency in this in this game here. Next, you know, I've done so many questions where I've been like, oh, is it September or November? Wow, like, it's really difficult to tell. And then I go through and I do a complex mathematical sum, write it down, get the answer, and I look down, and only September was even an option. It was a complete waste of my time figuring out between September and November. I could have just skipped that step. So exactly what Conrad says, look at that question, then look at the five answers, and then go to your graph or your table or your number problem, whatever it is. That's when you do it. So for certain, I would get straight in. You can skip, you can use it so well to skip. And again, when you're looking at the answers for a lot of the number ones, you don't need a precise, often you need different level of precision for different answers. Sometimes the answers will be like 33, 34, 35, 36, and 37. So you need to figure it out pretty precisely. But sometimes it's like 10, 40, 100, 260. At which point you need, you're estimating, not calculating. That's the sort of level, you know, I've done practice papers where I spent time like trying to figure out whether it was 241 or 240 or something, right? Like I've figured out really basic, and then it's a waste of time when I get to the answers. So I cannot stress enough how much time that will save you. The other thing I would say is, like, if there is a particular type of reasoning you are weak at, so I didn't take maths A level, so I knew my maths was a bit weak. I just spent a lot of time doing like times tables and doing basic calculations, because as we've said time and time again, time is the enemy here. If I can speed up my times tables, as basic as that sounds, that will increase my mark. So that's one thing. I was really bad at spatial reasoning, unlike Carlotta. Like, really, really bad. Yeah, I did one of those aptitude tests. I'm pretty good at like most things, but like I was in like the bottom 10% of the population for spatial reasoning. So I just went online and found a psychometric test and just did like 15 spatial reasoning tests until I felt like I like hit an all right level for the actual test. Stuff like that. Like, really just target your weaknesses and then cut down on time. These questions aren't too bad generally. And it's with problem solving questions, you're more likely to get stuck for time. So it's more likely that it's on one of these questions where you need to skip it. If it's taking longer than 3 minutes, skip it, come back to it at the end if you have any time left. That these are the sort of questions where like one of them can eat up 8 minutes. If you're not careful.
Just for anyone who doesn't know, can someone explain what spatial reasoning is?
Sure. So it's like manipulating shapes in your mind. So it's like, they'll be like, oh, there's a cube, and it's got like numbers on each side. Imagine if you spin it X, Y, Z, where does it land?
Sounds a lot like chemistry. All right, so moving on, do you guys have any advice for the critical thinking questions in section one?
Yeah, so once again, I'm going to say two things are really, really important for the critical thinking arguments, at least in my experience. The second of which is, again, heuristics, which I'll speak back on. But I think the first thing that you need to understand, which is, again, where reading can help, is the structure of an argument and the idea of an argument. They're going to present you with fairly basic arguments, which are often going to have one of five things explicitly. Premises, these are the sentence used to arrive at the two. Conclusion they want to arrive at. Very occasionally, they'll have intermediate conclusions. So a series of premises will get you to an intermediate conclusion, which in itself becomes a premise for another final conclusion. And then you're going to have assumptions. Now, these are things that aren't explicitly stated, and for the TSA, will never be written down explicitly. But is a piece of information, no, an argument essentially that you need to make in your head in order for something to be true. And then finally, principles. And this is a bit of a hard one, but think of a principle as the rule, like an overall rule that is trying to be established by the paragraph that you're reading. And so those are five categories. Those are really important to know what they are and understand how they work in an argument, because then that gets you onto how you think about some of these heuristics. And like, you could go through so many of them in so many different ways, and so many little tips and tricks that you can get from books, or things you actually just will discover yourselves. But for example, I mentioned the therefore test. If it's what's the main conclusion, it will always be something that you can list every single other explicit premise and say, therefore, read a sentence in the paragraph and it will make perfect sense. And the TSA has written that hopefully it should be the only sentence that makes perfect sense. And if you spot something as an intermediate conclusion, that might work, but then the thing about an intermediate conclusion that differs is you can add therefore after it and it will work, which isn't going to be the same for an intermediate conclusion and the overall conclusion. And so initially thinking about what's going on here as essentially a dance between those five different things is going to help you do things like going to see a paragraph, highlight all the premises instantly, highlight the final conclusion, and so on, because it's really a lot less literature and esoteric than it might seem at first. It's very much a puzzle that they've written to go between these things. So that, think about it in that terms would be my advice. And then, yeah, get your heuristics just from practice and reading around.
Yeah. I think one way to think of it from a more like a really tactical perspective is that if, let's say there's 25 critical thinking questions in a paper, 10 of those are going to be really easy for you, like super easy. You're going to read it. You're not even going to need to reread it. You're pretty confident with your answer. Another 10 of them, you're going to be like, you'll be able to figure out probably, but it's going to be a little bit tricky. You might need to reread it a little bit and you may end up making a mistake. And then 5 of them are going to be really hard for you. Those are the ones which you're going to need to spend a lot of time on in order to get the answer. Now, if you think about like how you're working towards the ultimate test, you just want to try and like push as many of those initial 10 like up. You're trying to just make as many of the questions as possible easy. So you just want to get as familiar as possible. Don't bother with those final 5, as it were, because you don't want to get those final 5. You want to get the intermediate 10. It's all about the middle ground. It's kind of like voting, I guess. And to do that, that's exactly what Connor was saying, is those heuristics. And it's like figuring out the patterns. Just by practicing, you'll be figuring out the patterns. But I would also suggest like explicitly thinking about the reasoning and the patterns of the answers in the past papers. So for example, one of the questions that they always ask is, what is the flaw in the reasoning, or what is the flaw in the argument? And there are different types of flaws which are recurring. Like one of the flaws, for example, is that there is an assumption which hasn't been filled in. That's one example. Or it's a red herring, or they're overgeneralizing in the conclusion. Like, these are all classic flaws which are displayed and which you will want to pick up on. So if you start picking up on those patterns, you're going to expand the amount of questions which you can answer easily, and that will save you time and make you more accurate. So that's really how I would go about it. One thing I would say, like some more quick advice, understand the difference between drawing a conclusion and what the main conclusion is. When asked for the main conclusion, the conclusion has been stated in the paragraph, so it must have been written down. If there is an answer which was not written in the paragraph, that is wrong. For draw a conclusion, the opposite is true. It is something that was not written in the paragraph, but which can be drawn from the paragraph. So if there is an answer which is essentially the same as one of the sentences in the paragraph, that is wrong. It is a different answer. It's really more to distinguish those. Another quick piece of advice is for the parallel reason question, I found it really useful to actually just write it down in like logical terms. So it's really easy to look up basic logic. And if you're applying for any course with philosophy, and it's worthwhile spending an hour looking at it. But if you write out the logic of the paragraph, so it'll say something like, all fishes are green, I like all green things, therefore I like fishes, or something like that, right? You can reduce that down so it's just a generic argument, right? So it's like, all X's are Y, I like all Y's, therefore I like all X's, something like that. And then you just apply that to the five different answers, and it will become so much clearer, so much more quickly which one is the correct answer. So that's another quick tip I could give.
Nice, wow. Is there anything that you found helpful when answering the critical thinking questions, Carlotta?
I think everything has been said.
Nice. And then moving on, so you guys mentioned there's past papers, I believe, on the Oxford website. Are there any other question material that you can find if you wanted more than the past papers?
Yeah, so I'd like to just quickly jump in. There are books, which we will talk about in a second, which give you extra questions, and I use them. They are not quite the same. Like, a lot of them are quite similar, but they're not quite the same. If you want pretty much the same, you can for free find extra papers by just looking at different types of tests. The BMAT has a critical thinking section. I can't remember if it's part one or part two. I think it's part two. But they are the exact same type of questions. They just have four multiple choices rather than five. I think it's the GMAT has something similar. The IMAT, these are all like aptitude tests which are used by Oxford, which are like exactly the same, and they're, you can use them for free. So I think between them, there's something like 50 past papers. So it's like more than you'll ever need.
Wow, nice. So moving on to books then. Were there any books that helped you guys prepare for the TSA, starting with Carlotta?
Yeah, so I got one of those, and I can't say the name because I don't remember what it was, and I don't have the book anymore because I gave it to my school after. But basically on Amazon, if you search TSA, there's a bunch of TSA past paper books, and maybe Jamie and Conrad have more. I'm pretty sure that I just sort of went for one of the first ones that came up. But if you know any specific ones that are really helpful.
Books wise, I used three. So one was Ace the TSA. I can't remember exactly who, but I think Neil something, which was very good for, again, a lot of these heuristics at the start. The other one was the Ultimate TSA Guide, which was pretty decent, but I really used for the extra like 300 questions it provided. And the last one was Thinking Skills by John Butterworth, which I read and is really good for some of the stuff we've talked about on arguments and critical thinking and being able to like form logical patterns, especially when you haven't studied this stuff. So those were the three books that were helpful for me.
Yeah, I also used the Ultimate TSA Guide. I thought it has like a short breakdown of like how the different questions are. I thought that was a bit weak personally. But the extra questions were pretty useful. The first book, which I think Connor was alluding to, which again, I can't remember the name of, that was a really good book I bought. I can't remember what it was called, but that one had like, it like talked about some of the things that Conrad and I have been kind of talking about, which is how I know he's also read it. That was really useful. And then one which I helped write is called it's called the TSA Guidebook. And that's really useful. I'd recommend it. And associated with it, the company makes a lot of like videos breaking down the answers. So it'll help explain them for any questions that you really don't understand. I can recommend using a couple of those if you want. But yeah, to be honest with you, I think the books are like extra. They are useful if you've already done practice questions. But if you haven't done the practice questions, they won't be useful. Like doing the practice is so necessary.
Nice. Yeah, I will add a list of these in the description for anyone listening. So just more about the books. So besides the fact that they have extra questions, in what way specifically were the books useful for you guys, starting with Carlotta?
Well, like Jamie just said, I think the book I used had a sort of section breaking down the type of questions, but I didn't actually find that helpful. So it sort of, it said, oh, you need to take these steps, and those just didn't seem to be what I was doing. And I found sort of a different system of like through practice again, developing these heuristics of how to approach the question worked for me rather than going with what the book said. So I actually thought that was the weaker section. And the practice questions really helped for me, especially the maths practice questions helped me practice that numerical reasoning. But again, I would point out that if they're not past papers and they're sort of extra questions, they're not exactly the same as the test will be. And it's really important to also do the past papers, because I think I noticed studying them, I was scoring better on the questions from the books than the past papers. And so the past papers are out there. So use them and use the books in addition if you run out of questions or you want to practice one specific type of question more.
Nice.
Yeah. No, it's worth pointing out that like when the Cambridge assessment who make the TSA, when they make it, they test it on students. And they then they will send out like more questions than they need, and they find the ones which have the right like level of difficulty. And also the same people have been making it for like 12 years. So they're going to just be so much more like what you're going to get in the real thing than the books. Again, practice is one of the things I found really useful in it. The book, which kind of broke down those different forms of critical thinking question, I found really useful. The other thing I found really useful was that they outlined precisely what for knowledge you require. So like, you need to know like your kilograms and liters and all of that.
Yeah, that's the point.
Like, they have like a list of like all the different like things. It's very basic. None of it's beyond GCSE level. But I hadn't done GCSE for a couple of years, so I actually just went back and like did like year five questions online for hours on end, because actually it was just really good at strengthening that like that knowledge, like my really basic stuff with timetables, conversions from different metrics. And again, speed is the currency, and it gained me a bit of time.
Nice. Wow. It's very like unique ways you guys went about it, even though you might have used the similar books. I also liked how Carlos, you were saying that you looked at what the book said and consumed what the book said, but then actually felt that your independent way was the way forward. And I guess that highlights the important point that the books aren't like the Bible or like word of law, using it as like a resource and then going with your intuition is probably the way forward.
Definitely useful add-on. Like at this point, I don't want to put people off who are like, oh wow, you did all this prep. I'm fundamentally a very lazy person, which is why I tend to be so efficient going about how I work, looking for like the least I can get away with. And so the books were really good at helping me not have to realize some of the things that doing plenty of papers down the line, you would have inevitably realized anyway. So that was really the number one usage for me. So,
yeah. I should add actually one thing, which is that some of them suggested methodologies and approaches to the papers I hadn't thought about and did use to my advantage. So what I mean by that is that some of them suggested, and I want to put my hands up in advance, you do not need to do these. They may not work. They are questionable methods. Play around with them before you do the actual test. Some of them suggested doing problem-solving questions first, then critical thinking questions, or like doing them in order, or breaking up like the order. So some of them even went as far as being like, do the conclusion questions, then do the floor questions. I tried those out and didn't find it very beneficial for me. What I did find beneficial, which is really weird, again, don't suggest doing it necessarily, is doing the paper backwards. The official line is that the questions do not get harder. My personal experience was that I found that the questions got harder and I wanted to do the hardest questions when I was intellectually freshest. It's a really tough test mentally, like, because you're essentially focusing nonstop for 90 minutes and really applying yourself. By about 70, 80 minutes, I was flagging. Personally, I found the first 10 questions pretty easy. That helped me. But again, that's like a maybe. Don't take it with a pinch of salt is basically what I'm saying.
Yeah. No, I think that just goes to show, like, it's worth practicing, playing around with to see what works for you. And if the book says try doing these first and then those, maybe try that out and it might work for you. And it's just, practice will get you there.
Yeah. I did the actual test backwards, so it's possible.
Yeah, I know as a rule of thumb, like for my exams, that doing the harder questions first has its value, because then if you can't do it, your brain will still be tinkering over the question, and then you might have the answer and then go back to it. Could be placebo effect that you thought the last questions were harder, and then a placebo effect that your plan worked. So yeah, it shows that belief is sometimes more important than truth, I guess. So do you guys think that any prior A-level subjects prepare you for the TSA? So like, you've got your A-levels, do some A-levels that give you an advantage, maybe not an advantage, but have similar skills that you're required for the TSA?
Honestly, maybe maths, but personally for me, that's it.
Yeah, I would say definitely don't choose A levels so that
you
definitely, like, there are no subjects you need to do well. Like, I did three S. I did English literature, Latin, and philosophy. Right, I was not preparing for like TSA style type for questions. I got in, so you can definitely do it fine. As Conrad says, you probably do have a benefit if you've continued your maths. And maybe if you've continued an SHL subject, because I felt like I was able to read through arguments and paragraphs and find the reasoning more effectively. But you can definitely pick it up, no matter what.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I did section one and for chemistry, and I'm not sure if they do that anymore. But and I didn't do any humanities subjects, and I was always curious to see or to know if the humanities A levels had any similar, like, critical thinking skills.
I mean, like, yeah, I could rant for hours on how bad I think humanities A levels are. I think there's a reason why at least PPE, which is what I do, doesn't have any required humanities. The truth is, the reading those little introductory chapters on premises, conclusions, is going to give you as much use for the TSA as doing 2 years of history will do. So so I wouldn't worry too much about a lack of like, I think it can help you get used to the feeling of writing an essay and, like, knowing how to structure an essay. Some of the really basic stuff that people just who haven't written essays in 2 years just kind of do forget. But again, that's also stuff a little bit of practice can instantly get over. I really don't think there's much of an advantage at all.
Yeah, I think with the critical thinking, it's kind of like cutting through the crap. And you can get that from a humanities A level. You can also just get that from reading the news. Yeah. Like, if you read the newspapers, they will they're a columnist, they will write an argument. Some of them are great, some of them are not so great. You can go find your own flaws and assumptions. Like, that is the same idea.
Did you have any ideas, Carlotta, from like your high school subjects?
I mean, I'd been out of school for, so I took the TSA 1.5 years after I took my IB exams. So I was fully, like, I knew no maths and had definitely, like, had not written an essay in that amount of time. And so just, I think I did, we'll talk about section two in a second, but yeah, I think I did like a practice essay and that kind of got me back into it. But if you have an essay-based A-level, that'll probably help in kind of structuring an essay. But that's also something that, like, writing out a few essay plans and just getting your thoughts down on paper will help you do too.
Nice.
Yeah.
So moving on. You guys are saying that this was important before we started recording the podcast. I'm still a bit unsure why. But so how is the TSA marked? And why is that important for me more so than anyone?
So, I mean, I think it's less how it's marked as, like, which is important as against what the marks mean. I mean, it's like marked by machines, not the wonders of technology here. but what matters is that they give it like a normal distribution. It's a funky method. You don't really need to know about it. What does matter is that they kind of center the average Oxford or the average TSA paper mark at about 60, which is basically how it works at like humanities at Oxford anyway. And then they'll make it such that a good, like a strong mark is 70. And then like an absurdly good mark is like 80 plus. So you're unlikely to get 80 plus. You're doing really well if you've got 70 plus. And you definitely want to be hitting that 60 plus mark.
Do we, like, obviously, like, we don't know anything concrete because we're just students, but do you guys know any rumors of like what's required for different subjects?
Not really. Yeah, I think the fact that it changes on subject to subject is very useful to know. Essentially, if you're doing a more competitive subject like PPE, it will likely have a higher general requirement. But I will say that the way that the specific mark is used is very much like dependent on year on year and also college to college. And to be honest, tutor to tutor. So I wouldn't spend too much time thinking about precisely how like this is going to factor into an application. Know that it's probably quite important, to be completely honest, the TSA. It's one of the things that that's going to be really well looked at for an interview. I can at least speak for PP with certainty when I say that they have three tiers of what's important for overall admissions, and interviews in the TSA are the things that are in the top two. So in general, for every step, it's going to be reasonably important, but it's not necessarily that the be-all, end-all, or used in this really specific way that we can note down. So try and do your best, but I don't think it's worth speaking about it.
Yeah. The general method of admission, I believe, and I saw one thing for PPL to this effect for when I was applying, is that when they're looking at whether or not you're going to get in an interview, they're going to be heavily relying on the TSA, and they kind of want you to hit like a cutoff point, and if you get under that cutoff point, they're unlikely to give you an interview, but they will if you hit certain other contextual factors. That often involves, for example, if you have really good GCSEs and you're from a less, from a school which basically isn't very high achieving. That's one example. Then after you've had your interview, it's still used. So like if you've got a really high score, like 80 or something, that will boost your application, but it won't necessarily get you in. But you can still get in even if you've like got like a reasonably low TSA score if you like excelled at interview. So it's something that will boost your application. And as Conrad says, like there are different cutoff points depending on different years, different colleges, yeah, different courses. So it's not worth really looking into that in too much depth. Mm. And you may end up getting into it anyway because of contextual factors.
I know when I was applying to Oxford in general, like 4 years ago, I don't know if this is the case now, but as like a general rule, this isn't true for all subjects and only true for some, and might not be true now, but they did say that Cambridge, their admissions test for some subjects weren't as didn't work as a sieve as much as some Oxford admissions test does. And I think from what I've heard, it's for some subjects that takes the TSA, there is like a one of the indicators of if you're going to be an interview or not.
Yeah. Doesn't it? Yeah, I mean, I know what you're referring to. I will say Cambridge and Oxford did find very different results on this. It was specifically about the relationship between these admissions tests and overall degree qualification. But in general, like Oxford does seem to prioritise it more than Cambridge. Same for GCSEs. So like, this is true. It's not something I think should matter too much to an applicant though.
Yeah.
It's also worth adding, the extent to which admissions tests are being taken into account is decreasing. The admissions tests have had their golden age and are in decline. I have sat in meetings where people have noted essentially that the relationship between admissions tests and performing well at Oxford exams is not as strong as they thought. And so they're not necessarily being like used more and more each year. So they're still important, definitely, but it might be changing in the future. They might be getting rid of it in the future, sort of thing. And I think the way to look at it is, it's not like, I think a lot of people look at it and say, oh, it's really ridiculous, it's savage, it's kind of brutal, the way that they have these cutoffs. But actually, it's probably better because we all know that with A-levels and GCSEs, your results are highly dependent on your school, unfortunately. Socioeconomic status is very well correlated with it. So they have a better ability if they're giving everyone the same test from the same baseline, where ideally you can't really revise for it. As Conrad says, it's pretty much you can get a bit more efficiency, but you can't really revise for it. It's a test of intelligence. So if anything, it's actually hopefully increasing access a little bit by trying to find out who actually, is really intelligent, even if their school is lower achieving and so their results are lower achieving too.
No, definitely very true. But I don't think it would say that you can definitely prepare for it as you all have for like as an explained back like lots of hours and hours, even if it is a test of attitude for sure. So moving on to the next question. So there's section 2 of the TSA. What is section 2 and any advice for it?
So I think just before we jump on to like specific advice and prep we did, section 2 is the essay section. It's a very, very short essay, 30 minutes to do it. And to be honest, it's not really the most important part of the TSA. It's not marked centrally. It's generally marked by graduate students at the university themselves. And so this also varies from tutor to tutor. Sometimes it's a case of if your TSA marks are very closely compared with someone else and they need to work out who to filter in, they might look at your essay. Other times, as long as it operates within a certain range, tutors are essentially completely indifferent. If your essays are really bad, then that's a cause for concern. But the essay is not worth stressing about nearly as much. That's sort of an overall caveat. I don't know if anyone has anything to say before we jump into advice.
So the university for all courses has central guidelines on how admissions work. Some subjects, they must have marked the TSA section 2 and they must have given it a score. For some subjects, such as PPL, that's not the case. They do not need to have looked at your section 2 to give you an offer or to reject you. So for some subjects, it's more important than others, but for all subjects, the section 1 is more important than section 2. I have sat in some tutors had steadfastly believe that it should be taken into account and love, they enjoy reading through student section 2s. Sometimes they choose to bring it up in interviews and they enjoy bringing it into account when they're making their decisions. Some tutors have the opposite point of view, refuse to read it and believe it's not worthwhile taking into account. So, I mean, yeah, like there's such a range of ways it can be used. There is no one way to go about it. But ultimately, as Conrad says, don't stress too much.
And how did you guys find doing section 2, starting with Carlos?
Like Conrad said, it's 30 minutes, so it's a really, really short time to write an essay in. And I had done that before in high school. But again, I think that you don't use as much time to prepare for section 2 as section 1. But definitely, I think, do a few sort of practice sessions where you look at the list of questions. There'll be like, I think, 4 different essay questions, which will really be, four or five? And write a few of those and just kind of get a feel for quickly writing an essay, quickly developing an argument. Planning is key. I tend to sort of take out time to plan. And then if you really only have 30 minutes to write, you don't have time to go back and fix sections and do this and that, but just, you know, plan out your sections, write it down, and that's done.
Yeah. I would say structure. Like, unofficially, this is the mindset I went in with, was the structure is significantly more important than the content of the essay. As long as you're not writing like absolute trash, they don't want to see, like, they don't need to see a super complex argument. They need to see someone who can write in a structured manner. That is what they're looking for. I will give some very concrete advice in relation to that, which is spend time planning, at least 5 minutes. Spend time checking. It's only 2 sides, and like barely even 2 sides. It does not take, like, it's 20 minutes max is required to actually write the essay. So spend that time, spend your time checking and planning. The second piece of really concrete advice is to not write outside of the box. This is such a strange thing to say, but they want to see that you can write within that box. That is literally the aim of the essay. They do not want to see you write more. It's not about quantity. Yeah. If you wrote 1.5 sides and it was well-structured, that would be full marks. That would be a perfect, like an exemplar response.
Yeah, I want to say a bit more about this because I think this is really important. Essentially, I think it's a good idea to have an idea of what the criteria is they're looking for specifically. This is not an A-level essay. They don't expect you to know anything. Frankly, the people who are reading this aren't going to be blown away by the arguments you come up with. Or if they are, then frankly, you probably don't need to be watching this video in the first place. Call them up and they'll give you an offer straight away. What they're looking for, and the reason it's in such a short space of time, at least like when I wrote down this, like Gaming for Gardens, it's really tight focus on the question. Clear and concise writing, really well organized, showing clear chains of reasoning and a clear understanding of the key arguments and objection. I repeated clear concise loads of times because that's really what this essay is testing. It's about, are you able to write clearly and show clear understanding in a short space of time? And so this point about not needing to worry, but people were saying things when I was looking for guidance, such as read loads of the news. You want to have like an interest in all the potential questions that comes up. Frankly, they're not looking for that. If your argument is logical and it's sound and it's really clear and it shows a clear like engagement with what's gone on, and you show that you're able to have chains of reasoning in place and not just waffle, you'll be fine for the TSA essay. You will not have reason to worry.
Yeah, I would say come up with a structure for like, that you know, go in with a structure in mind that you're going to do. Like I knew, I was like, I want to write two sentences of an introduction. I want to write three, about half a side paragraphs. And I want a 3 or 4 sentence conclusion. And that is it. Exactly. Bam. And I would strongly recommend that structure. The introduction is, I understand what this essay is about, and this is the essay I'm going to write. And your 3 points are just very simple. It's 4 against 4.
Yeah.
And then you conclude by weighing them up and landing on a side. And that's another thing I would add is, you know, this isn't a work of scholarly literature. Don't try and find a nuanced middle. Just land on a side. It makes it so much easier for you. You've only got two sides. So, you know, say it might be something like, oh, I don't know, for and against Brexit, right? Firstly, you don't need to choose like arguments you necessarily believe in. Like, keep them really simple. Like, start by saying one reason in favor of Brexit is that it will prop up British agriculture, right? And then you give an example, and then you give an explanation, and then you summarize your point, and then you go on to the same one. It's the same structure. It's almost like a GCSE response. It's not exciting or really that interesting, as Conrad says, but just have that structure practiced by doing the practice papers, and then you walk into that exam and you know exactly what you're doing at almost every minute of the assessment.
Nice. I was just wondering, you know, with, at the beginning of the conversation, you were giving advice about section one and the different types of critical thinking questions. Does understanding those types of questions and what premises are into conclusions and conclusions help with constructing this essay and maybe essays in general?
I think it can help. It can help as far as like being really concise, because every sentence you'll be making is going to be one of those things. And think about it in that way, it's going to prevent you from waffling. But beyond that, like I wouldn't say it's a super useful thing that's going to get you an instant 80 or something.
Yeah, it's probably not that useful, but when you look at the arguments in the critical thinking, they are purposefully jumbled. They are purposefully often flawed. They often use, and we didn't talk about this, but they often use viewpoints that they know you won't agree with to try and trip you up. They want you to focus on the logic, not the sentiment, right? They want you to come down on a pro-Brexit conclusion because they may think that students are more likely to be against Brexit or something like that, right? Because they're wanting to look for that logic. So you need to use like the reverse of that in this. You want to be super clear, not at all jumbled. You want to say, this is my argument, premise, intermediate conclusion, premise, conclusion, summarize your point, next one. Right? You want to be nice, like you want to be the ideal critical thinking question, essentially.
Nice. I think that sums up really well. Before we finish, is there any last advice that you guys had that we haven't said?
Yeah, I'd like to end with sort of just both welfare in preparing and also welfare during the exam. I'll start with the latter because I think that's actually easier. Make sure you go in like calm, cool. Know that it's very likely, in a lot of cases, you might not finish the paper. I didn't finish the questions. I had about 6 or so questions left at the end. I essentially just had to guess, and it's designed to be so time constrained that if you're finding you're not sweeping through them all, that's okay. And it's perfectly normal, and it's what they expect. And like, I think taking care of yourself both before and afterwards is so important for getting you into the headspace. But it's going to help you do the best in the actual paper. And so I definitely like just want to echo that and hammer that home, really.
Yeah, definitely make sure you guess all of the questions, like, at the end, if you don't have any time left. Like, if you're lacking five or six, like Conrad, you're probably going to get one right. That probably help. But yeah, I would generally say, like, I'm all for treating as anything, as almost anything, as a scholarly exercise of intellectual rigor. This isn't. Do not treat this as a piece of work you need to be proud of, because quite frankly, it's not. It's a test. So just go, like, treat it as an exercise, is it essentially what I'm saying? Do a bit of practice. Make sure you get a good night's sleep. You're eating well. Do it. Forget about it. That's essentially what I would say.
Anything to add, Carlos?
I mean, on what Jamie just said, forget about it in the end. I mean, I don't think the TSA results come out before Oxford announces its offers, right? And I was actually, because in preparing for this, I wanted to see what my score was, because I don't know, I don't remember. I know I checked, but I don't know what my score was, and I can't see it anymore. So it really, in the end, yeah, it's an exercise that you're going to do. And rather than staying up the night before and panicking all morning about this, make sure you have your time to practice, to figure out what the questions are like, then take care of yourself, do the exam, and good luck on the rest of the application process.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of trying to stay relaxed, for exams, I've always found that looking at the worst case scenario of what if, and then looking at that, having to have perspective always helps. Like, if you did horrifically on the test, like, what is it, the end of the world? And yeah, and then going from there, and then you can go in with, like, I know, not stressing, because there's nothing, I guess, nothing too much to stress about, hopefully. And then obviously that's also easier said than done.
I would add just, like, one more thing, which is there is room for improvement. I did the first test and I was really upset because I got like 54, which is basically not, it wouldn't have been good enough to get an interview and probably wouldn't have been good enough to get a place either. But like, even after two or three papers, I saw massive improvements. After 30 papers or whatever it was, I saw big improvements. And ultimately I managed to get a score which was over 55 and which got me into the university.
Nice. I actually, before we finished, I wanted to ask, I don't think we've talked about this either. Which one do you think is better, or I guess ideally to do both, but going through more past papers, or when you go through each past paper, making sure you go through each question afterwards and really fine-tuning where you've gone wrong, but then that meaning you do less papers?
I personally just don't think either are better. I think they both need the other in order to be effective TSA revision.
Yeah, you need to have done three or four papers before you sit the paper. So I would say, if you're like, if you've done one and you're like, oh, should I do two or three more, or should I go through this one? Definitely do two or three more. Once you've done like four or five papers, you're going to see less returns after just constantly doing more papers. Now, that's when you want to start thinking in the way we discussed, in a bit more depth.
And you will figure out which questions, sort of which type of question you're better at, and which ones you're just not getting. That's what you will figure out by doing more past papers. And then it's a question of sitting down and for the questions that you like, every time you see them and you think, this is the conclusion you're drawing from it, why is this not the right answer? Then you sit down and you try to figure out what you're getting wrong. And so it's a combination of the two, I think.
Okay, nice. Well, that's a long podcast today, but that's all that we've got time for today. Thank you guys so much for joining, Jamie, Conrad, Carter. The amount of useful information in this podcast alone has been so, and I've managed to be so helpful for upcoming applicants, and there's so many applicants for these subjects, as far as I'm aware. But yeah, that's all that we've got time for today. Thanks to the viewers for tuning in, whether that's on our podcast or YouTube or IGTV. And hope you all stay well, and we'll see you guys next time.